Right, Chris, firstly, there is a page in the Motoring Journalist Handbook, which I'm sure you carry a copy around in your back pocket, that says, with a handful of exceptions, fast, very fast SUVs are bad.
Yeah.
Very fast estates are good.
Yeah.
Why does that make you look like a hero and that makes you look like a Burke?
It's funny, isn't it? Because the dimensions aren't that different. You know, it's a bit taller, a bit longer and a bit wider, but there's something about it. It's trying too hard. And I think they present an ugly face of motoring. They're too big. Also, they tend to be driven in a certain way and they tend to have certain number plates and that kind of thing. Whereas, what's that saying about you as a human being? Let's not forget that our motor cars are a projection of how we want people to perceive us.
Sure.
And this, to me, just says, I want to carry a big stick and talk softly. And that just says, I want to walk around going, ah, to everyone. And I prefer this approach.
And you're artfully avoiding this, but your co-presenter clearly doesn't assign to the same sweeping assumptions as we do.
Well, they both like an SUV, both of them do, but in fairness to Pad, you know, that's the car he's being an advocate for in this film, and this is the one I am, but he still really likes this.
Yeah.
But he's probably a bit more relaxed about the fast SUV thing. I just don't see the point.
No,
on the road, why would you have a car that weighs more than it needs to, has a higher centre of gravity than it needs to, because it doesn't offer you anything more with those compromises? Now, if that car was bigger, more spacious, safer, more efficient, I'd be fine with it, but it's not.
I think the perception might be that there's some off-road genes in there. There's clearly not.
How often is it going to go off-road? Look at the tyres.
Never, never. But I'm trying to reason why people might buy it.
Its tyre says P0 Corsa. That's a track day tyre.
That is a giveaway. All right, we're going to take the cars in turn, all right?
Yeah.
That's with the RS6. Why is Audi's RS division, why does it blow so hot and cold? It's so hit and miss. For example, new RS4.
Yeah.
Good car.
Yeah.
Not brilliant.
Yeah.
RSQ3. Bit of a turd.
Yeah.
This, almost perfection.
Yeah,
what's going on?
I think it's great. I'm not sure I'd go with almost perfection. I think it's a logical step from the last one. It's still not as good to drive as an E63S.
Okay, why is this so much? Why is this so appealing? Why does this kind of work?
Because
with
this
an
is
RS
the package.
Badge?
This is the package. All of these fast car sections of car companies have their sweet spot. BMW tends to be the M3. But this, the RS6, is what they know best. You just get a feeling that when they sit down in Ingolstadt or wherever they're based and go, right, let's do the RS6, they're very comfortable with that type of car. It's the right size. This A6 body lends itself perfectly. They know the balance of speed and refinement. They also know that they've got the market sewn up. Mercedes have been hammering away with E63 for ages, but they don't even make a dent into the sales of these things.
Yeah.
And if you're a Swiss banker, and that's not a euphemism, and you want to go really fast between, Zurich and the mountains,
yeah,
you just buy one of these. You don't even look at the reviews. You just order one now.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, there's a new one. Great.
Yeah, you just get that. It. So, yeah, it works. It just works brilliantly.
Okay, we'll move on to the Lamborghini now. Now, anyone that follows you on social media or has stood within roughly a kilometre of you,
yeah,
ever,
yeah,
will know you're not exactly a Lamborghini brand ambassador. So
I used to be. I bought one of the bloody things.
Yeah, right. But right now, you're not.
Yeah.
Give us your unvarnished opinion on the Lamborghini Urus.
I think it's the epitome of badge engineering when it goes wrong, because it's a Touareg underneath that's been over-designed to the point of absurdity, both inside and out. I mean, the interior makes no sense whatsoever, nor do any of the lines on the exterior to me. It's incredibly fast, and I think it's pretty competent as well. But it's a car that shouts about your arrival before you arrive, but doesn't offer anything really to me. I mean, that sloping roof means it's got no room in the back. It's just not for me at all.
Interestingly now, you can have, and I drove one the other week, an RSQ8.
Yeah.
So essentially that tech package in Audi SUV.
But I think the Audi looks better than that.
Yeah.
I do. I think the RSQ8 isn't
the one. I had was on 23-inch wheels.
I don't know. What's really difficult to get across is that I admire what it can do, because it's a brilliant piece of engineering, but it's just not what I want to be seen in or what I want to drive.
Yeah.
Every time you'd be impressed by what that can do, you'd realise this does it better.
Yeah. So Lamborghinis, you said you owned one in the past. What did you
I had a Gallardo when they were brand new.
Oh.
And I think...
Manual?
Yeah, it was a manual, yeah. Very early, one of the first 10 that came into the country. I loved it, and I loved what Lamborghini stood for then. I thought the Mercy was a great car all the way through to the 640s. The Aventador was the bit of a drop-off for me, because that single-clutch gearbox...
Yeah, ruined it.
You just got the feeling that Lamborghini then shifted towards being something to be seen in rather than to drive.
Yeah.
And for me, when I started doing this job, Lamborghinis were about driving. They just happened to look outrageous.
Yeah, maybe from the Gallardo, but the Countach was...
brilliant to drive, mate. Go and drive.
Really?
Go and drive Harry Metcalf's Quattro Valvole 5000. They were proper driver's cars, and now it just reeks of lifestyle to me. And I know they've got a two-wheel drive Huracan now, which I'm told is pretty good.
Yeah.
But the Performante, it was fine, but whoever would have one of those to drive over an RS Porsche or a Pista or a Speciale would have to have a head check, wouldn't they?
All right, so the Chris Harris consumer advice out of these two cars is to buy the RS6.
No, I wouldn't buy either. I would buy a used RS6 last version, because this is, for me, not a massive step on. The four-wheel steering's clever, the cabin's a bit cleverer, it's got the 48-volt electrics, so it's a bit more efficient, but it's not a quantum leap. I'd buy one for 40 grand, the last version, take it to in Lichfield, have it chipped to you-know-what, get 750 horsepower, smoke all the people in these new ones,
yeah,
and spend the rest on whatever you spend it on.
There you go, top tip.